I'm your instructor and host of this program, Chris Burdett. We're in week 5 of a 13-week course, and we're getting past the introductory material, and we're now getting into the intricacies of what I think is one of the most interesting aspects of public relations, the public relations campaign. This class is not just a class, it's also a television show, despite the fact that it is a course. I want this to be boring, so I encourage people out there in the greater Los Angeles area watching this on Channel 36 or whatever your local cable outlet is to give us a call during the program at 800-339-1193. That's the number, 800-339-1193. First, though, before we get into the program, I want to just talk a little bit about the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes broadcast live on this cable television station and webcast on the internet each week. This fall, we're broadcasting 4 classes: anthropology, comparative social political systems on Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m., labor studies, which is the class immediately before this, on Saturdays from noon to 1:40 p.m. This class, Communications 365, Introduction to Public Relations, which airs from 1:50 to 3:30, and on Sundays from noon to 2, Humanities 310, The Theater of Revolt. If you have completed the first 2 years of college, you can earn your bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All the courses you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years, and voila, we'll repeat them again. If you'd like more information about the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, visit our website at www.appliedstudies.tv or call 1-866-278-6789. See on the screen, 866-278-6789. Okay, on to the class. If anybody who's taking the class has any questions about the procedures itself, feel free to give me a call on the air or send me an email, a personal email. We're about 2 weeks now out from the first midterm. I'll be giving you some information about that. We cover the first 8 chapters on the midterm this week. You should have read chapters 5 and 6 on research and carrying out public relations campaigns. Well, next week we'll be covering chapters 7 and 8. And then we'll give you a little bit of time to study, and then several days later, I'll be posting the exact dates when the exam will be online. That will be available for you as well. Okay, last week we ended up by watching one of the real political spinmeisters, Frank Luntz, who runs his own political public relations outfit in Washington, D.C. Luntz is one of the people who popularized whole idea of Wordsmith, taking something that might be unpalatable to an audience, like an estate tax, the idea that you're going to be taxing somebody's estate, no matter how large or small, and turning it into a death tax, which then becomes something that everybody would want to vote for, because, after all, it's certainly unfair to tax somebody after they're dead. Similarly, last few years, we saw that in the clip that we saw in the video of Persuaders last time. Lutz took the term global warming and turned it into climate change. So you see a lot of that in the political arena today. Today we're going to see a little bit more of Lutz at work, as well as look at other largely political campaigns. Our guest today is scheduled to be Bob Gold of Gold Public Relations, who will be expanding on some of his experiences in the greater Los Angeles area in terms of doing market research and also doing his own campaigns for his clients. So I'm looking forward to hearing from him. But first, let's look at, once again, at Frank Luntz. This time in this particular clip, he talks about just what are some of the keys to good communication. And above all, this particular company is trying to indicate what does it take to sell investments in children. What does it take to sell investments in children in the current political climate? Let's take a look.
So basically, they have the numbers. If you ever want to know about that, there's a 21 version of the internet moment. But you know what? Half of the battle is policy, but the other half of the battle is communication. And you're not communicating effectively, then you're not going to win. All the facts in the world don't mean anything if you don't know how to explain them. But the best example is about the media voters, which are not the best communicator in the last 50 years. This guy, he loves your name. Senator Rock, he caused your pain. At least he felt it while he was causing it. He mentioned John Kerry, and then John Kerry. The problem with John Kerry is that he looked like the tree in the Wizard of Oz that came out with Dorothy. This was a guy who showed he absolutely empathized with the next generation of young people. I had a smile on his whole. All of his communication, all of his messaging. Did you ever see him smile? His wife's worth $1 million. If my wife were that rich, I'd be like, I'm in the sky. Someone said to me, you never met your son's Gary for $1 million? I don't care. If you look at the Republican position, with the president, I know you're used to 50-50. You and John Kerry would never stop talking. You absorb proof that you have the smartest sense. I think that's what you need to do in the debates. Three words, a noun, a verb, and some sort of punctuation. I have 21 words for the 21st century. By the way, the name of the book is great for me and great for you. This is what we all can benefit. The book is called Words That Work. It's all my neck here. It's actually selling in the Barnes & Noble. It's right near here. And there's a chapter on it. On children. You get it on Amazon. Focuses on language, but I want to take out the situation. The first one on the top is the most powerful law of action. If you're trying to communicate the importance of children in the budget, you're trying to communicate the value of focusing on education, focusing on child welfare, focusing on welfare, it's imagine how proud we will be when you're going to show them the health care that they need, the health care that they deserve. Imagine the strength of the economy and the strength of the society. Every child is educated to their level, and they are encouraged to achieve their dreams and go beyond. I'll ask these questions. I'm going to do it really quickly. Tom, when you think of kids, and I put the word imagine, what do you imagine? Imagine learning a little bit more. We're not bullshit. You can't give me full sense. It's... picture, as your imagination does, each one of you have your own picture of success. That's what imagination is all about. It can be found most powerful the word imagination is imagination showing that you are passionate about learning. I saw moms and moms go to New York City where moms are mean. I need a mean senator from New York City. Over here, get the hell out. Is with the idea that teachers who are passionate about their students, and students who are passionate about education, that's what imagination is all about. Innovation. It's not about saying when you talk about kids, it's just about dollars and cents. You're not going to win the battle, you're not going to win communication. And I understand that you change it to investment, but spending, you're calling me everywhere, aren't you? Why are you busy shopping? Innovation is what we're looking for young people because innovation is totally about the future. Innovation is taking a process that we use right now and doing it even better, more effective, more efficient. It's not the dollars that we spend on children that matter, it's how that money is spent. All right? That's the way you communicate the transcends by the right Republican, Democrat, this organization that's right here. So the quality of the investment rather than the quantity. innovation sets, more efficient, more effective analysis is smarter, which is what we're looking for. Those last words, renew, revital, as rejuvenate, restore, and renew, and my colleagues know that we work for businesses who can't use any of this stuff. Others in the record know that it's the most popular political figure among young women. 15, 16, 18, 20 years old, she's such a role model. At 15 older, she's reading these slides, and that one is my older men don't like Hillary Clinton. She wants them all in the first wife. This is definitely a Republican, it's a Democratic power, it's a power. Today, even 15 years, she wants women of their first husbands. But 15 years left office, the Unabomber had a higher favorability rate. We knew our commitments to the next generation. We finalized our education system, our healthcare system, the way we deliver social services. We rejuvenate the passion that young people have for the world around them. Our belief in the American dream. The most powerful thing you can do in a communication of a naked color is going to be the one that warning I'm out here and he's back there. I'm considering an answer to these two questions. How many of you believe that you have a better quality of life than your parents did? Your age. If your mom life is better than theirs, raise your hands. Almost everybody in this room. Now raise your hands if you truly believe that your children will have a better quality of life than you and they did at your age. Well, now your hands go up. If you begin your presentation with that question to any audience, you'll hear a murmur. People will look around and they'll be depressed. And then you have a chance to make your case. That's about restoring commitment to the American dream. It's the number one definition of the American dream. It's being able to give the better quality of life, a better country, more opportunities for our children, for what we got ourselves. Restoring the American dream and enkindling the American spirit, the can-do spirit, and reinventing the way that we deliver services, the way we help young people.
I see Frank Luntz at work trying to tell a business audience how to connect the message on how to improve the life of their children and how to get that point across. So that's one thing that's very, very interesting. I think I'm very interested in seeing what your thoughts are. Are Luntz's techniques, most of the techniques he uses, he picks up on individual words in terms of telling clients who are about to go out into their own professional venues, tell them the message that he thinks will work particularly well. Does that kind of a technique work for you? Is that something that you like to hear in a speech? And if any of you work in any of your jobs for employers who use these kind of techniques, in other words, does this kind of short messaging work for you in your workplaces? School, you don't need to be working in school. When you hear a speech like that, when you hear somebody using Luntzian type techniques, and I just invented my own word there, Frank Luntzian techniques, is that the kind of thing that tends to move you? Give us a call or send us a message, we'll talk about it. I'd like to go into another Frank Luntz clip, and this is from the 2004 presidential campaign again. As you recall, George Bush was facing off against John Kerry. You can see from the previous clip that Frank Luntz didn't have high opinions of. In this clip, Luntz does several different focus groups where the first one is talking about Hillary Clinton, looks at the numbers and takes apart just what is it going to take for individuals to win. So let's take a look at this clip, which is on Fox News, where they're talking with Frank Luntz.
We lost more than 10,000 weather. These are chance now. I've been doing all the well in the polls for the past couple months. Whether it's Tom McCain could be the likely Democratic nominee, at least at this point. Hillary Clinton. It's quite interesting to hear what our voters might see. Let's listen to those votes. I think he's got the experience as a veteran that he brings to the table. What will he be? Hillary Clinton?
Absolutely. Clinton is so divisive. There are going to be many voters that are just not going to be able to put their name on her name their ballot.
Show me, has somebody walked in here without a committee candidate? Raise your hands. Firstly, everybody, how many of you walked in here supporting Mitt Romney? Raise your hands. How many of you are going to leave here supporting Mitt Romney?
His corporate leadership experience, I think, will also benefit our economy.
Romney comes across very clearly and concisely, and I can see him being a viable opponent. As a Democratic nominee, I don't see that coming out of here.
The remote studio is too small for all the candidates who participate.
My understanding is there will be a table in the Fox Box room, the Fox Box, and the infrastructure is like this trailer thing we build outside. It's fairly expensive and nice, but it is an old looking. So they want to put five people around the table who first while it's in some of these issues.
You know, why not pull up another chair?
Okay, a little bit of liberal opinion in that one. Again, you know, a criticism of Fox News, which is certainly not known to be the nonpartisan voice of political coverage. I was wrong on that last time. Fox News, 2008 and 2004, but we still see Fox, you know, exercising the same techniques that he did before. Let's take a call. Got a call coming. Jonathan, calling from Los Angeles. How are you doing today, Jonathan?
I'm doing very well. How about you?
Great.
Thanks for taking my call.
What's on your mind?
Well, I may be mistaken, but my understanding is that Frank Luntz is of the Karl Rove School of Politics, where anything goes as long as the goal is attained. And I should say that I'm a what I would consider a true conservative, but I'm forced to vote for Democrats because they more truly follow fiscal responsibility.
Why is that? If you're truly a fiscal conservative, why would you be voting for, and I'm just throwing this out, why would you be voting for Democrats if, especially since most conservative Republicans at this stage are talking about how Obama and his programs is increasing the deficit?
Well, that's not clear. You know why the deficit was increased. And look at the graph of deficits and Republicans. They always match up. I'm not making this up. It's the biggest hoax there's out there. GOP hasn't done anything about deficits and increased them. Well, that's why I have to vote Democrat.
I don't disagree with you with that at all.
Then why are we having any discussion about the GOP not being a hoax?
Well, I'm just pointing out that most of the, right now, the message is coming from the, and I would agree with you, from the left or from the folks who are, you know, trying to tear down Obama, basically attacking him on the fiscal spending aspect. So, but I agree with you in terms of Bill Clinton, when he was president, the budget was balanced by the end of his term, and certainly George Bush ran into big deficits. But go ahead with your point. I'm sorry.
Yeah, but let me say one thing further, and this is very sad for our country. So much of our attention was taken to try and destroy Mr. Clinton's administration. So much of our FBI's energy that we didn't notice that terrorists were coming into our shores. And I think the same thing is happening now. Republicans like to talk about security, but the fact is that the more federal people we put on looking for someone's underwear, the less we're likely to find people who would murder us.
Yeah.
And it's happening again.
Well, let me take us back here. Because when you first called, you indicated you were appalled by Frank Luntz. What is it beyond the fact that he's Rovian that specifically irritates you?
I must say honestly that anyone who would uphold the quote-unquote neocon or conservative position right now without apologizing for what they did to the country, to everyone, these conservatives, Frank included, they're going on as if nothing happened, and they like to say the deficit of Mr. Obama. No, first, the GOP has to apologize. We need an apology. And I say true conservative is, I believe, fiscal responsibility and individual rights and small government. And you don't see that on GOP platforms ever since Tricky Dicky.
Okay.
What you see is dirty politics, and I'm sick of it.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Have a good day. All right, next city call. You know, you never know what you're going to get. Somebody identifies themselves as being conservative, so they'll be lining up, attacking Obama. In that case, it's the uses. He's a true conservative who is definitely hasn't seen too much good out of the GOP's insertionism. We've got a comment coming in from Mike. Words very powerful and slogan crazy. However, I think it is wise to use simple techniques like this in public speaking, since it's more likely that the message will be remembered. And Brandy writes in, agreeing, yes, short messaging works. It keeps you focused on the message being conveyed. And gives you time to go into your own memory bank to see how his suggestions relate and inspire your own goals. I really like his, meaning Les's, incorporation of humor keeps you interested, and those are the best types of speakers. Okay, so a couple of positive things as far as the fact that those kind of messaging works for them. Okay, now let's look at this. I promise you, the 2008 presidential campaign. We're talking about with Frank Luntz, who not only does the polling, not only does the focus groups, but also his take in this has become this one thing we see a lot of. You see people who are seen as so-called polling experts, media experts, actually turning into commentators on networks. And here Frank Luntz does a little bit of pre-debate analysis of the Obama-McCain campaign on what kinds of negative ads work against Obama. Let's take a look.
Americans want to hear from the candidates. What guy always knows is Frank Luntz. He is a pollster and author of Words That Work. He joins us live. Frank, great to see you. As you sit there to watch the debate tonight, they probably have rattling around in their brains a lot of the advertisements that they've been saturated with. A lot of them have been negative. Is there an impact?
There is an impact, and some of the impact has actually been negative on John McCain. And if there's one ad that he tested in our last on the side of our panel the middle of last week in Virginia that scored incredibly well. In fact, it was the best testing of all the negative ads in the campaign so far. It was won on behalf of John McCain, not reporting his campaign, by a group that Freedom Ring, the ad deals with Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. Let's roll that ad. As viewers watch the lines go up, the more favorable the reaction to the ad, the more credible it is, the higher the lines apply. So watch the negative ad. That works.
On the debate stage, you are benefiting politically from the financial crisis from your campaign facts. How they can vote for him. John McCain tried to blow the whistle on Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac over 2 years ago. In 2006, he told the Senate, for years I have been concerned about the regulatory structure that governs Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. The GSEs need to be reformed without delay.
In order to make their political contributions to oppose the reforms John McCain was calling for, Barack Obama, Christopher Dodd, John Kerry.
Mike, what means better? Guests who receive campaign contributions from the people who drove Freddie and Fannie Mae into the ground. Barack Obama, Christopher Dodd, and John Kerry.
John McCain saw this coming. You, Senator Obama, have been part of the problem. What happens when you meet the senator who's part of the biggest financial crisis in U.S. history? Please, America, let's never find out. Which is responsible for the concept of this ad.
Yeah, and it reached mid-60s, and the Freedom put an ad together that really gets to the core of the economic crisis. And that's the message that John McCain tonight. And what was going to be asking for, what is your solution? Can you prepare your solution with Barack Obama's views as the language President of the left Freedom Ring had? He couldn't come out of time to make one.
Welcome, we're back. Very glad that there you see, there you see Luntz working with Fox News, where he is one of their regular political contributors. So, again, if you're a public relations practitioner, and Luntz doubles in advertising and public relations, he's also able to carry that into the political arena, much on the Democratic side. our earlier caller was very well involved. People over on the conservative side, I think the closest comparison to us on the liberal side would be Jim Carville, who worked with Bill Clinton in the 1990s and has since morphed into a political commentator on TV. And interesting, his wife is Mary Madeline, who is a Republican political operative. So the two sides, apparently, the similarities. Don't get into the relationship. The fact that one of them, the fact that they're attracted to each other, doesn't seem to matter so much. That one's a strong Democrat, the other is a strong Republican. I guess that's just the way it works out. Okay, let's turn away from the political arena, although the difference between political public relations and ads for products oftentimes can become very blurry because it's the same sort of techniques. Last time, saw some of the video of the persuaders, and I wanted to take a look at that again this time from the beginning, where it talks about all this subliminal messaging that we see in the campaigns that are going on from my staff. Let's take a look and watch that first 5 or 6 minutes. Then we'll take a look at a specific case study. Before getting to that, one of the students, Shoemaker, wrote in that he provided a study guide for the midterm. I will put out something that should give you some sort of a guide as to what to look at and whether it's looking at everything from the midterm. That's probably not the best way to study for the midterm. I think the best study guide actually out there are the PowerPoints that I posted. I post them every week. That will serve basically as your best way of taking what the chapters are. The other aspect that you will want to look at in terms of preparing for the midterm is the content of the program itself. Looking at some of the guests, what they had to say, as well as looking at some of the clips and messages there. I will provide a specific study guide that will simply list each of the things that we've covered in the course. Is what you need to know. So hopefully that helps you out a little bit. Take a real good look at the PowerPoints that go along with each chapter, because I think that combined with some of the key terms in the chapters will really help you out a lot. Okay, Nate Liddy wrote in, most people remember bumper stickers for our year than long dissertations. As somebody who wrote a long dissertation and actually got it published, I have to agree. Very few readers of long dissertations, people like short messages. I think Frank Luntz, Hicks says, has the idea of words, of course, you can hang your hat on, which aids the practitioner's campaign. Some, I think, may be a bit insulted at the expectation that such complicated issues are expected to be digested in simplified cash phrases. So, there we have Nick's view. I agree. Short, sweet, intense work, whether it's in advertising, public relations, or journalism. They see a picture of what something looks like. That means a lot more than actually reading it, that actually delves into the deep content. But we'll go on more into that a little bit more, because I think Bob Ross campaigns with Bob Gold. I'm going to get into the persuaders, though, so let's take a look at this 2004 video, which takes apart the ethics as well as the persuasiveness and the effectiveness of Madison Avenue in their campaigns, whether in fact all of this advertising is in fact proving counterproductive because there's just too much of it out there. Let's roll the clip.
You cannot walk down the street without being bombarded.
They call it a clutter crisis. Sewers are like roaches. You spray them, and after a while it isn't working, and you do clutter communities. And the multi-billion-dollar advertising industry is in a desperate struggle to break through.
We don't just come forward with what we want to sell. We engage you with things that you want.
Advertisers can blur the line between programming and product.
This advertising that people not only will tolerate, but will actually go in search of.
One more part of the clip. This is about
This talks about a very specific campaign that will be the judge whether it works or not. It's for the airline song. I don't know how many of you thought on Delta, but several years ago they created a spinoff in order to appeal to a specific target, young women. Yet, you know, today's song is no longer in business. Is it because it failed marketing, advertising, public relations campaign, or is it for other reasons? When we come back, we'll have our guest for the day, Bob Gold, who will help us take part in this video as well as some of the material he's brought in as well. So let's take a look at the rest of this particular clip where we're talking about song and the airline.
Song is a subsidiary of Delta Airlines, but you won't find any mention of Delta here. Delta is old-fashioned air travel, and Song is their way of persuading us that they can compete with low-cost carriers like JetBlue.
A lot of people ask if you can increase the airspace in an airline into the worst environment in the U.S. in the history of U.S. and commercial aviation, and we were, and we are.
Best marketers and told them to start from scratch. The first thing the song team decided was that it wasn't enough just to launch a new airline. To get a position, they had to invent a new culture around flying. But how do you do that?
Talk to me a little bit about why you chose the things you did. And
the song started with a trust puzzle. The focus
was. Choose images, words, things that capture what might be your ideal experience of traveling by air.
Before long, Song's research yielded an idea. There's a large group of flyers whose needs and desires were being ignored. It was incredible insight to say this could be the first airline that had, you know, a real, you know, understanding, much deeper understanding of women and women's interests. The Song team created a detailed profile of their target consumer. And he gave her a name, Gary.
She's got three children, a husband. They both work. They have an SUV and a sports car. Even Marcus credit cards, but she shops at Target. She has got a propensity to read kind of high-end literature, but she finds guilty pleasure in People magazine. And she doesn't have an airline.
Song would have low fares, organic food, and more entertainment options. But most importantly, it would forge a real connection with women. To pull that off, Song turns with Bro, Andy Spade. Spade is the co-creator of the Kate Spade Company, a multi-million dollar line of fashion accessories that caters to women like Gary.
I think early on when you're shaping a new brand, you need those brand visionaries. He's got a gift and he's had it from the very first time we started working with him, and that's why we love him so much. He gives us more than we get ourselves.
A track player in this thing. Right, ideas, kind of visualize ideas that the companies have and give them kind of substance and a texture and a life that they may not know how to create. And I bring that into their idea or their point of view. And I try to create this maybe something that's bigger, maybe emotional, maybe optimistic, you know, maybe classical, maybe, you know, happy.
Spade's been charged with producing Song's TV campaign. The first impression the airline will make on many Americans.
All right, so why don't we start with creating a campaign for Song that's spirited, that delivered on the benefits that we think are the most important, through in a way that's emotional, deep in a way that I think is optimistic, because we believe that's part of the song he does. So we're going to take you through four different concepts and five different commercials that cover our five different benefits, which we believe differentiates Song from everyone else.
Spade is proposing to downplay the airline's new features in favor of something much more intangible. It's so
local lovers here, which I don't know if many of you are familiar with the local
Chris, I'll pass it around. These sweet, sweet images, we were kind of inspired by this a few times. I just tangled together. And then you could go out into your phone movies and all those little French New Wave films, and then their American films. Space commercials will show no planes, no scooters, no low bears, no airline. This is an enormously risky strategy. These commercials estimated will consume almost a third of Song's $12 million marketing budget. If the campaign doesn't connect, Song will just become part of the noodles, and Delta, at the brink of bankruptcy, cannot afford for its new venture to fail. At least one member of Song's team is nervous.
Well, the risk is you invest an enormous amount of money behind a message that is a fairly ethereal message that, as they say, doesn't feed the bulldog. I mean, this is a business. This isn't an art form. So we have got to ensure that it's communication that drives commerce, not just makes people feel good.
The number one purchase driver for this category is, in fact, first price. The strategy is the everyday low price. Aeroline that happens to have more style and everything else that we're doing. The more we pull back and try to make it a very, very kind of literal delivery on a benefit, it just lost that emotion. We wanted to keep that emotion.
Spade isn't backing off. He's not content just to convey information. He's aiming for something bigger.
At the end of the day, you want to become a part of culture, and when you get to that point, you've created a huge success. And that's what all great companies have done. Conversion to Apple and others. I think by spending 25 seconds on style and spirit, this is a four in your category and you have to get there first. That's more important than really pulling the spot around or third or anyone who's going to be looking there. What really differentiates something from another thing, I think, is creating kind of something that communicates to people on another level, beyond a logical level.
The question is an advertising classic. Should the pitch be aimed at the head? Or the heart? How creative can an ad get and still be an ad?
Someone once wrote a book called Advertising for Myself. That's what advertising is. It's advertising for the guys who are creating it far more than it is for the guys who are paying for it. They're trying to win awards, they're trying to make more money, they're trying to build their own portfolio, they're trying to get a better job. They're trying to make up for the fact that they're in advertising and not direct consultant or stand-up comedy or painting paintings or whatever they would prefer to do, I guarantee you. And the consequence is a lot of advertising is quite extravagant and it's longer, very clever and entertaining and funny, but which doesn't do the thing that advertising is supposed to do, which is make you want to buy the good or service that's nominally being advertised.
Visit part of the song, go to the song campaign with our guests who I want to introduce right now. Bob Gold, welcome to our class. Public relations.
Thanks, Chris. It's great to be here. It's really great to talk to students and people interested in public relations. This is my life, and it's part of what I think is vital and exciting. Because part of what we're trying to do with public relations is establish a brand and an articulation of a message that resonates and is meaningful and connects. We are connectors. And that's what this class is about. And this is what we're going to talk about today, is what the process is for connecting and providing meaning to that connection between people.
Well, before we get started on that process, let's first talk a little bit about your business or your are you a solo operator, Bob Gold Public Relations?
Bob Gold and Associates is 12 years in the business. I was in corporate suit for many years. I worked at a PR agency, and ended up, if anyone remembers the old movie, a guy turned his hand to me and said, I have one more to say, cable TV, and I ended up being first on board to help launch a network today called Lifetime. With HBO, and what's now Fox Sports, also the first Spanish-language sports network, Avenida Deportiva, now called Fox Sports in Espanol, and about 12
some years. Some of our students have gone to work for you.
Sure. And I've had actually students from Cal State Dominguez Hills come into my shop 12 years ago. I started my own independent PR and marketing agency. because honestly, what we want to do is provide a cash flow that we can work on. When we're in a corporation, we can only see life like this from the corporate eyes. When you're in an agency, you're able to envision a world of allocations, tactics, and strategies to any problem. Song, we were just watching.
Yeah, we didn't take this system apart. That is a campaign that looked like it had, they had a very clear message. We were certainly using a lot of innovative ideas.
Did it all work? I'm a big fan of personally of Song. I love it. We were talking during the segment while it was running, and I remember that the flight attendants, we were going to call flight attendants, they were entertainers, and they had to be interviewed, and they had to have something to entertain, whether it was how to make some drink, doing something with paper napkins. That's a different experience. It's how when you came on the plane, you wanted the passengers to feel engaged, enthralled, cared about, and not simply getting from point A to point B.
Mm-hmm.
But keep in mind that the song was operated by and so, what is the real customer touch point where someone actually experiences Song first? You go to the website to make a reservation, and you go to Delta.com, Song took you to Delta.com, and there you book your flight. And you really weren't clear on the website if you were getting a flight on Song or on Delta. So you came and you arrived and you had this surprise experience. Execution of that test point, therefore, wasn't consistent with what they tried to do in the air.
Interesting. Why would a company, a corporation like Delta, make such a fundamental mistake as to take somebody onto their website? Well, I presume that they could, like I guess one of the reasons for doing it would be, well, you get them on our website, maybe they'll make a reservation with us instead, or we'll get into this as well.
Actually, that's one of the great questions that each of us faces in a daily way when we communicate. Who are we, and how authentic can we be to who we are? Delta executives created an idea in a marketing department to create a different flight experience, but it was still Delta with its aid, domestic and international travel experience, running something that was an offshoot, that wasn't profitable, that was the tail wagging the dog. We see this over and again, whether it's Saturn and GM or other side divisions where a company says we're going to create a new product experience, but we're not going to invest it with its own core identity because, in fact, the people calling the shots in the policy are from another place. So that takes us into a little bit of research. You find what your core is, what is the real place that you want to establish the brand. One of my favorite expressions is, what we don't know reinforces what we know.
Let's stop you. I have a question from a student here who made it as well. Union Shoemaker writes in, the Delta commercial didn't translate into dollars, but did it increase the public's awareness of the airline? So is there a side benefit there?
There was no fallover back to Delta. They tried to create two separate brands. Song operated independently. It was an experience when you got to the gate, you found out whether you were boarding a Song flight, which you didn't know was part of Delta, and you were in a Delta terminal. Just like today, you might go to a United terminal and find out there's a Northwest gate or a JetBlue gate that's there. Is it the same airline or different? Do that clarity, that spillover effect, additive. Not additive.
Yeah, sure. Voice, and this is a comment. Yes, I hope so. It's like when you were watching TV, they advertise what channel you were watching, whether it's CBS or NBC, but as if we don't know.
Joel, I love what you're saying. And in fact, research has shown people don't really know where they get their information from. Did you get your information from a PSA, public service announcement? Was it something you read? Was it a commercial on television? Was it the radio? Was it something over the water cooler that you had a conversation? We are inundated with information. in 1980s, late 1989, a group of researchers at UCLA, before the year happens, decided to say, how many messages would a call to action teach you something does the average consumer receive in a day versus wanting to guess? Anyone out there take a guess?
Thousands of messages.
Thousands of messages. If you think about the phone, the radio, the television, the newspaper, the memos that would happen in the work or school environment,
it doesn't just when you're walking, just when you're walking down the street, if you're seeing
filters,
or
absolutely 1,500 messages. So when Joel writes in and says, I dislike it when you're watching TV and the advertisement channel you're watching, in point of fact, let's not underestimate the incredible cacophony of noise that the average person is inundated with. And today, the internet has broadband, gives us even more geographic choices, so that we're in social networks, we're online, and reading blogs, and things like that. Way, we might be getting information on a mobile device like our cell phones. Now, it's this ubiquitous noise, all of which asking us to take action. And in public relations, marketing or advertising, the question becomes how much of an ask needs to be there before you change your behavior. Because in fact, in good public relations, we are trying to alter behavior. We're trying to get people to do something. If it's a television network, what's the most powerful thing, behavior, physical change, that we can evoke with someone at home? Either the remote control. Get to NBC, CBS, Lifetime, whatever that network is.
As a communicator, as a good public relations practitioner, it has to be, how do you cut through that noise? How do you keep the person from taking their vote and moving it up and down? Isn't that sort of the secret of everything? How do you keep the person focused on our message so that they'll go out and do it?
And in fact, it's the first criteria of anyone's messaging for engagement to say, I care enough to take action. So what happens is that people are saying, I need a message that's going to resonate. But the other, the listener will hear it and say, that makes sense. I want to do something. Think about Nancy Reagan. When Ronald Reagan was in office, he was a great communicator as the president. And she held an anti-drug campaign. If you remember this,
all they remember
it was just say no,
right?
It's very catchy, just say no. But for every addict, they are addicts because they are unable to say no. So just say no to an addict, asking them to say no when they can't say no, is in fact not going to get the desired result. Catchy slogan, fun to throw out there, in terms of reality and effect. Absolutely.
No. So it was catchy. It got her a lot of very positive publicity, which she liked.
Simple.
As far as the actual impact on drug use, no.
Right. It's almost on the same line today of when our churches or schools tell young people be absent. Sounds easy. It's something easy to do. But saying
that's a little bit more complicated than just
that. Yes, and it's not working very well either. We are today engaged in an environment where we're seeing incredible increases in the use of sexually transmitted diseases and others. The point is, a campaign message has to resonate to engage with action. And part of that is determining how you're going to go through a process to know what works. If we go back to what we don't know reinforces what we know, we're operating in a bubble.
Okay, my thought that I sort of to go on from this to talk about, well, we've talked about what doesn't work. Yeah, there are a lot of things you could ask, but I just wanted to bring some of the stuff that you brought in. You've been working on some campaigns. What does work?
Yeah,
talk about it in the abstract.
That's the abstract, and we'll drill down. So, first off, let's talk about what are our characteristics.
What are some campaigns that do work, and how do you get there?
Today, cable operators, as an example, many people get high-speed internet, they get video services, and they get telephone services from a provider. If you get a cable operator, it can be a phone company, it can be a satellite provider.
But the fact is they're all basically doing the same thing. It's almost a commodity. So you're fighting for market share today. You don't have really over-the-air television anymore that's available. People are paying for their TV wherever they live. And some people are paying for it by getting it online or through a wire or through a satellite signal. Well, it works. Let's go back a couple years. One of my favorite stories is Adelphia Cable. A lot of our students and people watching this are here from Southern California. Adelphia was one of the largest cable operators in the country. This is a phone call, if you remember this. The CEO and owner of the company was indicted for larceny, fraud, stealing money. The company,
I do remember the story. I was never an Adelphia customer, but I saw that story.
Company had a rate increase at the same time. Oh. And lastly, there was stock manipulation and fraud going on as well. So the politicians were screaming something is wrong. Financial Wall Street was screaming something is wrong. The lawmakers were screaming something is wrong. And there was a rate increase, so customers were saying, why are you bumping me ass?
I don't hear your client at the time.
That's when we got the phone call. And my wife said to me, hey, when you go to this first meeting, can you go to this company in crisis? Why don't you wear an orange suit to make them feel more comfortable? I came to the meeting with staff, and as we sit here in the conference room, one of my directors turns to me before the Adelphia executive team is, do you really want to be here? This is an overwhelming problem. And I said, absolutely. This is where we can make a difference. And so if you always just want to make a difference for having walked on this planet,
bottom line, yeah, all of us go through this life, we want to be successful, and being successful means we've made a difference, whether it be with our families or our work.
Yes. So the executives are power. Everyone has a point of view of what should be done. And if you were in public affairs, you said let's take care of the politicians. If you were in the legal department, you said let's take care of what's going on from a legal ramification. If you were in the financial department, well, we have to do it. Well, financiers were also trying to say, how do we keep our cash flow? I said, stop. Before we create any messages, let's go back to the customers and ask what's important to them. With all of this noise, with this daily headlines, with on television and newspapers and the screaming that was going on, let's go back to the customers because that's who we're trying to address.
Yeah.
So we did in-person interviews, we did telephone surveys, it was before really good internet chatter could be monitored. And guess what we found out? There were three issues, first and foremost, for every cable customer. Number one, when I get home, I want my television to work, and turn on channel 10.
That's the most basic. You tell them nothing about
nothing.
And three, merger, just I want my cable.
I want my cable to work. Number two, I want to pay a fair bill. I'd like to know I'm paying what generally everyone else is paying. I want to pay more, for sure. I mean, I pay less, but if I'm paying a fair bill, that would be great. And number three, if I have a problem, I'd like someone to be able to answer the phone and take my complaint and respond in a timely fashion. All right.
And nothing to do. I was going back to the playing game of football. And we have to take the ball down the line. It's not about where's the stadium. It's not about what the cheerleaders look like. It's not about taxpayer dollars to underwrite the football team. It's about how do we play the game.
That was highly refreshing. And from that, we then devised a series of saying, okay, who can we talk to? Now, traditionally, public relations, the PR professional says, I'm going to write a news release, give it to the editor. And we're a reporter and talk about a story. But we also had monitored what the tone in the media was, and it was entirely hostile.
So you don't want to be engaging the traditional media.
That's right. It was not the time to talk to the traditional media because we couldn't win that battle. It was too much anger. Mm-hmm. People already knew what they didn't know. So we decided the only way we could be effective is if we communicated directly to the customer, because ultimately, that's all we care about. If we're creating that customer experience, we created a series of spots called the created a series of spots where we created and delve in ambassadors, and these employees, and we rewarded them for taking extra time and proactively phoning customers to simply check in. And we monitored that, and we had an entire incentive program. So we had an outward bound actual call list that was given on a daily and weekly basis to employees to say, how are we doing? What can I do?
And they would call customers just to find
them. Yes, say, I'm an adult ambassador. I work for the company. I just want to check in. Are you having any problems? Is there anything more? And we created a series of questions for them to use. At the end of the day, the external spots that said, here's what we're doing, the external outreach that said, how can we help you? And that was matched with a new management that came in and said, we have to manage our processes better and execute, you know, in our game plan. And everyone pulled together. And in that experience, I will tell you that today, there are time warner cable customers who have said, gosh, I wish I still had my Adelphia. The Adelphia is not, it was so off of pieces, and time warner in some California took it on.
That's interesting because, yes, I can see how that would be a very effective campaign. You change you make the customers, which are telling people happy with the service, but at the same time, did you change the attitudes of the traditional media?
Yes, so the point of fact is we treated media as customers as if they were customers, and we treated them no different. We tried to bring them into the process and say, this is what we're doing, it is a process. You are right. There were things that previously were wrong. You know, people need an apology. People need to know when we have misspoken, misacted, whatever, David Letterman, and we behave poorly.
That's a whole subject right there.
Right. So it's really where we want to go today is to be able to engage in an honest dialogue.
Let's, you know, since you brought it up, I didn't think about it, but what about the David Letterman quote? Response to the, you know, to the, you know, to the alleged distortion.
Yes.
Well, was he effective in terms of his message?
So
those of you who haven't
heard the news,
yes,
evidently, a producer for David Letterman and someone who worked on some of the television top news shows on CBS, approaches Letterman and first says, I have a screen treatment about a talk show host having affairs with his staff and being manipulated this way. And so he gets Letterman's attention. And then there's a meeting where he says, I have photographs of you and these women who are staff members that are untoward, you know, unbecoming. And I'm going to release these, and a demand is made for $2 million to keep it a secret. So Letterman thinks this through, and really chooses to punch through, which is today, what's the one thing we are not as a society? We aren't honest and forthright.
We come. A lot of communicators tend to try to change the subject.
We call spinmeisters, not honest communicators. Honesty is the most refreshing and powerful form of communication we have. Because it's so rare. So, Letterman goes through television after he writes the check for $2 million, which is not real. The producer takes it and deposits it in a bank, tries to cash the check, and he goes to the meeting. Now we have someone taking a bribe, depositing the bribe, and there's clearly not there, and he goes to work, like, nothing's going on, and he comes out of his meeting and he's arrested, the producer's arrested. Letterman goes on television that night, and he says basically three things. We should talk about the power of three. One, I made a mistake. Two, let me tell you what I was doing. I had affairs with women who are on my staff before I was married. And three, I was being blackmailed, and I'd like to end this. I'm working with the police to come forward, and I'm hoping, what is this called action? I'm hoping I can keep my job. So now the investigation is in full swing on both sides, both of those who are blackmailing as well as two. Were there manipulations by Letterman on with staff that would be improper. You know, to say to someone or to essentially harass someone works for you so that their career is on the line,
right,
is absolutely illegal.
Right.
Communication-wise, he's done all the right things. He's on power surge in the ratings. He's doing very well. End of story, I will predict Letterman will keep his job. His ratings will only increase, and his humility and chance to connect as an honest person who makes a mistake and tries to move forward will give him grace to move on and be very, very successful.
Yeah, one of those moments later, which was in the list of these interviews, was about his comment to Sarah Palin, where he did much the same thing. He made a comment that was basically, Sarah Palin's daughter, being in New York, and she, she came back, and of course Sarah Palin came back and said, she never would have talked about my daughter. And then he comes back, first thing she said, sort of a half-hearted apology, and then he apologizes again. Another example of him being proactive and
being proactive
and being, being true, being somebody who seems to be a mistake.
There are a lot of us feel that we need to put out, I'm perfect, I have no feelings, I can take it all, I can be strong. It's not really very connective, is it?
No.
And in a public relations standpoint, if we want to feel that we care about the person and we want to take some action, we are all imperfect. And so, God made every dog to bark, every cat to go meow, and he made every human being to be imperfect. So when we reveal the imperfections and we own up to them and we say we want to be better, that's an incredibly compelling and honest moment in any public relations environment.
Hold on, Dr. Miller. I go back with people in the class or in the audience. Bob's brought up some earlier statements. It's the best way to communicate and be honest, but I'm interested in your viewpoint is asking Bob, is that something that you encounter in your life and you feel that you're most attracted, whether it's a politician or a product, to something that really does appear to be honest, or do you fall into the area where you will tend to go along with campaigns or product campaigns that are really, that don't really tell the whole truth and tell a message? So just in your thoughts.
And honesty is a tough problem. Think about it. We are limited by our lawyers as to how honest we can be because there are financial and legal incriminations that can happen from being honest to a mistake. You know, today in this country, if my son were driving down the street and God forbid were to hit another car and kill someone, our lawyers would tell us as our family, we are not allowed to go to that family and apologize.
You can't come out and say, oh, I'm so sorry to this.
That's right. That is, the law works against that. So we are in a society, we have a puritanical history, where we're not trained to be forthright and honest. And yet, every school teacher, every police officer, and every reporter is trained to spell a lie. And the one thing we absolutely say is the worst thing you can do is not that you had sex with someone, Bill Clinton said, yes, I had sex and I'm sorry. If Monica Lewinsky on the scandal would have gone over and we would have been done with it. Instead, he lied and said I didn't. And I spelled that lie and we were pounding and pounding and pounding away because what was important was honesty, not the action.
Yeah,
and we forget that.
Sometimes by telling the truth, you can lose. In my career, about 20 years ago, there was a governor of Ohio, his name was Richard Celeste. He was, I don't know if you remember that, he was also picked up. At that time, he was looking at running for president, and it was picked up that he had had an affair. And he simply went before the reporters, both state and national, and said, yes, that's right, and my wife and I struggled with this, and she's at peace with it, and that's it.
There's a lot of it. They moved on.
So
that's part of the good research process in public relations. What is the message, and what is the honesty, the level of honesty? Because we are spin masters. We're only allowed by legal to say so much, to admit so much, because otherwise there may be entirely very bad consequences that our corporations, our companies, our organizations will be liable for.
I want to go into some of the material that you brought up. One of the things that always strikes me is this time of corporate analysis. People are being laid off. Arts, isn't the public relations function oftentimes one of the first places where they see the cuts? Isn't that in many respects counterproductive?
Well, we are working in a very counterproductive, counterintuitive time right now. If you think about it, people aren't making the right choices every time. They're at least going to get through this whole process. I will tell you that PR jobs are absolutely critical. There are companies that are succeeding because they're becoming rethinkers about how we communicate. Today, one of the biggest cuts has been at newspapers and media outlets.
Right.
I see Fox and NBC have combined news groups, right? So I've told my staff, it was a time when we used to write a news release, we'd send it to a reporter, we'd call them up to solicit a story or a filing of that story, and then be printed in the media, and we'd communicate in this unilateral way to our publics that way. And today, that reporter is gone.
Right.
So how do we do this? How do we communicate, and who are we listening to?
There's much more problems. Let's go to Sarah Margo. It's funny how a lot of people are calling Letterman an honest guy. I feel the only reason he admitted these affairs was because he got caught. I also have
a problem with Letterman.
No, thank you. I also have a problem with Letterman mocking people in Brooklyn.
Yes, you know, it's a cut two ways. Will it work that way? You know, Letterman humor is a very tough animal. You know, Roseanne Barr was one of the most successful comedians and television personalities. She had a TV show, Roseanne, on that was incredibly powerful. But comedy means taking chances. And she went to a San Diego Padres game to sing the national anthem.
I remember that, yeah.
And she grabbed her crotch. Because what guys do, they grab their crotch to the ball game. It was a joke. But she, to this day, has never been forgiven for it. So, when a comedian takes a shot, we sometimes forget there's funny work here. How many of us have told a joke that landed on that because we thought it was funny? We thought it was great. I don't know. Forgive me. Do you know who the first PR professional was in the history of society?
No, we learned in this course that it was Ivy League.
Well, actually, that would be in the 1900s.
Yeah,
but 1900s. In fact, it was someone before that. Because if you remember your Bible, if you read your Bible, you know the story of Moses leading the children of Israel out of Egypt. And the Pharaoh and his army were in hot pursuit. And the army was behind them, and the Red Sea was in front of them. And Moses, like any CEO, did not know what to do at that moment. And he turned to his PR person and said, "What should I do?" And the PR person said, "I'm not sure, but if you can part the Red Sea, I can get you 2 pages of the Old Testament."
It sounds like a plan right there. So, Teresa writes, "When honesty is self-serving, it's the person who chooses to air his dirty laundry at the expense of his wife and family's feelings. Like Ted Letterman and other politicians, then I am not impressed. That kind of behavior strikes me as selfish, therefore somewhat dishonest." Agree?
It's not about being self-serving. Your honesty is self-serving. That's a really good point, Teresa. Are we, in fact, being forthright and honest? Or are we still being manipulative in our statement? And here's what you picked up. Was that Letterman is trying to hold on to his job. He's trying to not go down for having done something that may have been, we don't know yet, may have been illegal in his sexual harassment of staff. So therefore, how do we say it's okay now? And I think this is something still unfolding. There's more information that's going to be coming out. As a PR person, Teresa, what would you do and what would your advice be?
I would love to go to the office that came before. Give us a call. Give us a shout to what you think about the public relations strategy being used. Because it's not just, he doesn't get on the air and just say this. He knows definitely
strategizing exactly balance the word. They probably ran across the legal stuff. They don't need to say this.
So let's come back a little bit and talk about messaging and research.
Okay, that's because that's our count for weeks.
That's great, Bobby.
So that's something you have on your working on a campaign for Charter Cable, correct?
We're trying to get a chart that I wanted to share. I do a lot of cable TV, you know, cable. In fact, right now, it's an old word. It's an ancient word. And getting people to engage and feel good about their company is something I thought would be good. But first, why don't we take this question? Do we have another Nick?
We have the same people coming in all the time. It's great. More people feel free to, you know, to write in. Nick writes, I feel that any person, especially a person who sits upon the honor of a celebrity, needs to be honest. We all know humans make mistakes. Fame does not change. Fame does not change. This makes them to increase exposure when mistakes happen. To pretend that you don't make mistakes seems to reduce a person's credibility with the word of the ordinary man or woman, in my opinion. Not admitting a mistake can lead to people being unable to pass,
to get past,
the transgression and impossible to move forward positively from a PR perspective.
Nick, you are so right and on point. I think let's talk about celebrities for just a moment, because there was a time before we did our Great Depression in this country that we're currently going through, when there were only three things that could get news coverage. If you had to have a celebrity, sports, or entertainment.
And we learned that a couple of weeks ago from Rita and Tatum.
Yeah.
Again, and talk about the use of celebrities.
I'm here to say that's changed. We're burnt out and fed up on celebrities and what they go through. Every celebrity has their angst du jour, and I think people finally don't need to be like Paris Hilton or Roseanne or to be like David Letterman. We just want real people. But that's a relatively very new, I would say, in the last 12 to 18 months, we've seen this trending towards hearing from real people as opposed to celebrities. Number two, what was the nice thing to do? And kids are babies, right? Because they're sweet, they're innocent, and like that. You put a bunch of kids together stacking Oreos and seeing the greatest, tallest Oreo tower. That will get news coverage. You get a group of students from Cal State Dominguez Hills doing it. Nada.
Or kids, babies, or pets, or dogs.
Yeah, dogs. Yes. Yes. And so, in fact, one of the things that we're playing the Animal Channel, you know, some people might say it's the Animal Stuff Network, you know, we're celebrating hunting and fishing all the time. But we wanted to show that it's a lifestyle regardless of where you live. And therefore, we took one of the sports, which were dogs that jumps off of docks. And they jump as high or as far, and they get a little rubber toy, into a pool of water. And they were called dock dogs. And so we took this to Bryant Park in Manhattan, and we did this huge demonstration with thousands of people coming to watch these dogs run and leap off. And we had CBS This Morning do live coverage throughout the day, all the media there. Dogs, babies, celebrities, get coverage. Today, what person do you think is different that says we don't need celebrities, we can talk to real people?
Well, I'll start off with the idea. I don't know if you guys have heard of it. There was back in the late 1970s, you saw this huge surge of very emotional, let's bring this back home, you know, let's connect with real people. That was defined with economic unrest, economic troubles.
Our day, you can take care of this person in Africa.
Exactly. All of that sort of thing. Are we moving back? My point is, we're sort of back in that era. Not a lot of people look at the Saturdays, the LA Times report, the unemployment figures.
Yes.
Way above 10%, California almost 10% nationwide.
So the dynamic that I'll just offer, and I'd love to hear your reactions to it, is social media. We are a more connected society. And we care more about the opinions, which are immediately accessible through our Facebook, Twitter, Flickr, LinkedIn accounts, than we've ever been before in history. And therefore, whether I'm looking to do a dinner party in Denver and I'm posting on Facebook, what restaurants in Denver have private dining rooms. And immediately got 12 responses and ideas. Or if I care about what an issue is, it's something that's shareable, durable, and the recommendation from a real person that we know is immediately accessible. We are not as isolated as we once were, and therefore we don't need the celebrity to set the standard because we're doing it in our community of our friends, of our Facebook friends, of our MySpace, people that we're talking to, in a way that we've never shared and got that feedback before. We should be more, let's talk about Mr. West.
So how in public relations industry do you make maximum use of this development of social media?
Well, so back today, we talked a little bit about the issue, we're getting off topic, but a little bit of the issue of we don't have reporters to pitch stories to. That is a dwindling resource. But people are online and they are connected. And we are getting inundated with these messages and our Blackberries and our cell phones and our computers and a nonstop constant. Many of you are watching this as a streamed video, not even on Channel 36 or Channel 6 or another regional provider. So the point is, we now are building websites, having bloggers. We are communicating directly our thoughts, feelings, whether we do so directly and honestly saying we represent, or doing it where we have friended people who have certain opinions and we're helping them get their opinions further out. And to that extent, we're trying to influence legislation to get passed in the state of California. We are trying to bring greater transparency of the fact of the matter is, today, Obama's low rankings in the poll is that government has not succeeded in the things that we care most about. And it took us 5 years to fight World War II, and we're 7 years into Iraq and Afghanistan or more. And we are tired and burnt out of that. We are unemployed. We have high costs for living. The things that we really care about, Obama can say is health care. But at the end of the day, that wasn't a message that resonated back with the public. And so today, as communications professionals, we need to step back. Obama was, some people said, Obama was much better at becoming president than being president.
Right. But he still needs to try to use social media as well. If anybody contributed money to Obama in 2008 or even sent messages trying to get on his instant, back at the primary campaigns, actually, it was the next biggest vice president, email, maybe the first person that he got on his list. So he has this huge database and he's trying to use it for healthcare.
Yes.
It's not working.
Yeah, it was interesting. We didn't talk about a lot about the president, but the truth is that today it comes down to research. And then the second two strategies that are really important are research and research. We go in and we have to ask the question, what do you care about? What do you care about in regards to a particular topic? If we're representing a building development, if we're representing an initiative, if we're representing an organization or a company, we want to know what part of that makes you excited, makes you glad, or unhappy. We do that in face-to-face questions, we do that in telephone surveys, and we even do online surveys. There's a Starbucks gift card or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
You ask the question, and we talked about earlier how we live in a society that is not necessarily actually honest and truthful. How do we know if someone answers your question, they really are being honest? I'll tell you, as an employer, I've had people come and sit in a job interview at my office and show me my face, who wanted to work for me, who wanted to be in a PR agency, this is their dream and their vision, and within less than 30 days they said,
I didn't really like your place, I took another job someplace else.
Or, I'm going to leave and go on unemployment because I'll get something else, but obviously, people aren't necessarily honest with themselves. They're not sure what they're really about. And that is very tough. So research and ask me a question. Chris, what do you think of this airline or this cable company, it may be top of mind, it may be something recent, and you need not be actually honest about. In fact, if I'm given a $5 discount, I would be a happier customer. If you have an experience that we do a lot of in research, we make the same complaint with what if came. Same thing in a job interview. How would you behave if you were in this situation with all the fantasies? But if I turned it around and I asked you, give me an example. When you had a situation like this, how you behave and what you did, how you were rewarded, that's a very different question. Because now you're speaking from a historical, factual place, or at least as you recall.
Well, I want to get to the call. I actually want to tell you about the situation that just actually happened yesterday. I rented a car, I was out of town, and I rented a car for metal price. I didn't get the car that I really wanted. It was a little bit bigger than the car that I wanted. I took it anyway, brought it back 4 days later, and I was turning it in, and my expectation was to just see nothing. But the guy who was there, who introduced himself as being one of the managers, he clearly was interested in my opinion, and I told him, well, he was local, the car was great, but when you sold me the idea of upgrading to this new vehicle, offered this car, and he didn't. What do you think the guy did? That would be a fact. And what would be? He said, well, I'm sorry, man, this is true. So I'm going to knock off a little bit of the price. And then secondly, I'm going to give you a coupon for a free upgrade. I'm really sorry this happened to you. To me, that appeared to be genuine. A lot of times, these campaigns, and I'm interested in what other people feel out there, they don't seem to be very genuine. It's sort of like it's part of a
Yes. So we're inundated with gimmicks. We're inundated with people who are overwhelmed in their job, under resourced. And, as a PR agency, I say I'm so glad that people are so overwhelmed because before they wouldn't outsource their workload or
experiences like you said,
right? So thank you for being busy and overwhelmed. Now let's just talk about the amount of dollars you want to spend.
Exactly.
That's a different conversation.
Let's go to the call.
Yes, please.
It's from Redondo Beach.
Hey, how you guys doing today?
We're doing fine, Alex. What's on your mind?
Quick question. I've basically been a contractor, doing my own thing for that while. And I've been taking a lot of the other businesses that I work for and buying and trying to do a lot of guerrilla marketing, which I guess is that term, guerrilla marketing, but if the web is still diluted nowadays, then everybody's got a cool website, their website, it's easy, everybody can build it. I mean, we're almost, Bob knows, we're almost handed to being by a 15-year-old nowadays if it wasn't for just the knowledge that we've gained over the Bob stuff. I just wanted to know, is Bob doing a push for pounding the pavement marketing, as we can call it, or come up with something cooler, possibly get a cooler name for it. And just wanted to get his opinion on that, because I've been seeing my clients on that a lot, and I think if other people do, it might make a difference.
Okay, thanks, Alex.
And let me get back to that. Don't shut up, Alex. Let me ask a couple questions. Number one, is he a contractor, like a construction contractor?
Correct. I jump from different agencies to companies that from the small company to big company, and I'll just freelance on the side.
And so the question is, how do I promote my clients, these the construction contractor, better and more effectively in a market where just having a website is no longer effective? Is that right?
Well, more than I'm a big believer of actual street marketing, where there is a person. Not necessarily holding up the sign, but something shocking happens in the street where people, the eyes are around. Everybody can go to the website, everybody sees. I expect to see anything and everything on the website, obviously, nothing shocking. So, unfortunately, but when you see somebody doing something amazing on the street with somebody, that's actually advertising, it impresses me.
Yeah, but. Oh, Alex, I love what you're saying. You can come back to one of the core questions. Who is our target audience? Who is it that we're trying to affect that behavioral change with? And who is the person that's going to most likely to want the services that are being offered? We talked about Song earlier in this program, being an airline for women, but we didn't know that we
didn't say I need my own airline. They were creating, they thought they were creating a market for themselves.
That's right.
And, you know, so the same thing would be true as to is street marketing better. I'm always amazed that these guys or these signs over, they stand on the street corner and they see those signs and they turn around and they wear costumes and I'd be driven into a store or into a store
for that reason.
For that reason, have you?
No, never. But in fact, I'm more likely to sort of, well, what's up with this? Why, you know, draw attention to that, but not to the product? But
yes, you know, just come on in as a traffic builder. I think that there, you know, an advertiser says, I know advertising works. Half of my money goes to waste, and half of it's effective. I just don't know which half. So the same thing is true in public relations or in marketing, and we should talk a little bit about those lines.
Yeah, we talked about that before we came off, that in terms of marketing, advertising, public relations, the front offers, they're all just one of the same.
Right. So, let's talk about the process just very briefly. First, let's identify what our goals are. And I believe you can't have more than three goals. Why three? You need anything in our language that comes in threes?
Need something that comes in threes.
Okay.
You're putting me on the spot.
Yes. Something that comes in threes. And we experience in threes. Alright, first race round.
Okay.
Three wishes. Three wishes. Three little bears. Three is a Western concept that is incredibly, incredibly powerful. You have three goals. This is what the behaviors are that I want to achieve for my company, my product, my client, my contractor, whoever that is. And I don't care if you're General Motors or if you are an individual. Strategies are going to result from those goals, and they are the same regardless of your size, shape, or what you are. And therefore, strategies answer the question, how? How will I reach these goals? And to that end, you have to say, who is it that I want to reach? Because not everyone is going to use my product, my service, my experience, my association, or even care about my initiative.
Right. You have to target.
And so we go back to research. Ask questions. See who actually uses this product or service. What kinds of people tend to already be established. Who we get our financials from. That research and just pure data is absolutely critical to understand your audience because it may be that walking out and shaking someone's hand and going door to door and asking for the sale is the most effective way versus newspaper advertising, radio. But we have to understand the psychographics, not just the demographics, of what that audience is and does.
What that audience is. What they do, and what is the most effective way to reach that audience.
Yes.
So, isn't that oftentimes forgotten? People will, you know, campaigns will put out, you know, which to me is one of the most annoying things. Maybe it's the fact that, you know, telephone calls, phone calls, just calling up to let you know that you need to go to the polls, vote for proposition, whatever.
Or an electronic call, a voice is there telling you something.
Yeah.
It's amazing, and
it's unfortunate because we are overwhelmed, and we're getting sloppy and lazy, and in fact, these things are not working. What we are inundated with are a clueless humility of messages coming at us that are not for us. And when we watch television shows, we really care. I don't care about the products, but I'm getting those commercials.
We have a lifetime network. There's an assumption there. Isn't there that they would be reaching by the following audience?
That's the assumption. And so, of course, we all know that when you assume, you may be wrong.
Yes, you could be wrong.
You put that word down. That's something that you admitted. So, the bottom line is we need research first and foremost to understand our audience and what my target public is. The second thing we need research for is to develop the message. Because it doesn't matter how good
monopolized by the competition. There is very little that is uniquely offered by only one company or one product. And so what we try to impute in public relations is that point of differentiation, that you're going to want this mug with this shape versus this is to say they're entirely different, they have entirely different contents and a different shape, although they're both about black coffee mugs.
So what is it that you would do that would make this mug, which personally I find more attractive? But, you know, is that enough? Would you want a logo on it, or?
Exactly. So what would we do? Let's just say our product is a company that wants to introduce a line of coffee mugs and wants to know how to make it more effective because when you go to Target or Best Buy or the supermarket and you're going to get a coffee mug,
your first thing is going to be the appearance.
You know, and speaking of appearance, I always like to talk about shampoo. How many bottles of shampoo and conditioner are on the supermarket shelf? As many as the shelf holds. It's an entire aisle of bottles of shampoo, and typically the difference between one bottle and the other is nominal. It's the same thing. So there's a little bit of fragrance. So what's so different about each bottle of shampoo? The shape of the bottle, the packaging around it, and the promises made of what the shampoo will do for you.
So you're not selling, in this case, you're going to make it happen. You're not selling price. You're not selling it in the sales of the off-time around the launch by generic or by some less expensive products.
You know, I mean, you're right. In fact, we are talking about that in today's world, the lines, if you're a communicator, the lines between advertising, marketing, public relations, media, social media, have blurred. Of the onslaught of messages, we need to be able to address ourselves across all mediums with different tools and tactics that will communicate effectively and will resonate. And we'll show a couple of those when we come back.
Well, we're actually, what we usually believe, we're actually out of time.
It
really has fun. I guess I can see how this guy did a great job in terms of covering the material without going past the break.
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you.
It's been a great time. Yeah, a great guest. I'm going to go to the hospital.